Welcome back to round six of the Florida 2017 Regional Championships. My name's Gabby Snyder.
My name is still Adam Dorricott, as it has been all day, funnily enough.
Are you sure?
It's been like this for 24 years now. I don't think it's going to change between rounds. I might change it for tomorrow, though, just to mess around with people a little bit.
All right, making the plays. Anyways, we are back here with a very exciting match. Stephen Mea versus Giovanni Costa, I believe. Is that our...
Costa.
Costa. Anyways, Gio. The one Gio, the only Gio.
A very positive Twitter presence from this guy, so most people may know him off Twitter or his 10th place Worlds finish. Probably another good place to know him from, actually.
Probably. I don't know. I feel like Twitter might outweigh that a little bit.
A good Twitter game is maybe the secret to a good Worlds finish, and that's why I've never done well at Worlds.
Definitely. All right, so speaking of Worlds, you know, I did have the pleasure to cast a couple of Gio's games back in Arizona, and I believe he's running the same team, so I think it's definitely something he's very comfortable with. We'll have to see what Steven brought. I mean, I'm not really sure what kind of strategies he leans towards as a player, but, you know... For him to go, I believe, 4-1 so far in this tournament, he must be very confident with this team.
Yeah, this is a pair down, essentially, for Gio. He's currently undefeated at 5-0, and Steven is 4-1 with exceptionally high resistance. So this potentially could be an elimination match for Steven, although depending on who his first loss was to in the tournament, a loss to Gio wouldn't be the worst thing in the world, because obviously he'll be going at least 6-1 if that's the case. So a little bit more pressure on Steven here, I feel, going into it, just to make sure that he's going into potentially tomorrow very safely. But, you know, doesn't take any pressure off Gio at all. If you don't want to fall at the last second, fall at the final hurdle, and if, you know, he drops maybe this game, maybe that would put the pressure on a little bit too much, drop the next game, and all of a sudden you've missed cap.
Yeah, I mean, being undefeated at this point in time with only two rounds left, it's a blessing and a curse. If you know how to handle that pressure and if you know how to play well, then, you know, you can deal with it and you can win that one game needed and go into the last round ready to get cut. Or, you know, if you lose, then it's just even worse, I would say.
Yeah, nobody wants to go into the last round with a loss on their mind.
Not
we are
at
about
all.
To cut to the selection of both the teams, I believe.
All right.
So we'll be able to see Gio will be on the top, and we'll be able to see his team. And we have Steven on the bottom.
All right, so I'm going to start with Steven, actually. Kyogre, Groudon, Salamence, Hitmontop, Raichu, and Bronzong versus Gio's Groudon, Kyogre, Cresselia, Kangaskhan, Whimsicott, and Gengar. I love the fact that there's more Whimsicott.
Yeah, you're a big fan of the Whimsicott.
I love Whimsicott. It's such a unique Pokemon.
I'm not such a fan of the fact we have got the double primal mirror, which makes it very tough for both players. There's a lot of mind games involved in this, so we should be in for an exciting set. There's so much to this matchup, actually, particularly when it's a mirror. The switching and the control of the weather really separates the men from the boys in this one. So I'm looking forward to see, you know, which one they have. They do have very different supporting casts, though, and we've definitely seen this before. There's zero similarities. We do have a different Mega, Kangaskhan and Salamence, respectively. And then, you know, very different supporting casts. Raichu matches up against the Whimsicott fairly well. Maybe we see Steven going for a slightly slower approach to the team with a Bronzong, looking to maybe Trick Room. But Gio, of course, has the Cresselia that could match or reverse that Trick Room.
Yeah, so we'll have to see what these trainers decided to bring. We see that Cresselia right off the bat paired with Gio's Gengar into the Raichu Kyogre lead from Steven.
Yeah, a nice safe lead, I think, from both players here, trying to sort of suss out what the other one is doing. I really like the amount of pressure that Steven brings with this lead. I feel like maybe the Gengar's not able to do quite so much in this lead. It doesn't have the threat of being faked out, but there's not so much it can do back here, and I'd be interested to see if maybe he's trying to set up for that Cresselia to get a Trick Room in play and then bring in Pokemon to capitalize on the Trick Room.
Yeah, but you know, Steven has that Bronzong on his team. He has enough fake out support and possibly Tailwind in Salamence that, you know, I wouldn't be surprised to see a Trick Room sort of mode on Steven's team. So whether or not he decided to lead it right now to immediately capitalize on that Trick Room threat from Cresselia, we'll just have to see.
Yeah, I think both of these teams have different modes as well. Obviously, Steven's Raichu, if it's a little, we did see, of course, a very different Raichu in the last round, but maybe going back to that more traditional Raichu that we've been seeing recently with the Nuzzle, that could be his form of speed control, with Gio maybe looking. I feel with the Cresselia out, the Trick Room's a lot more likely. So It depends if they do get it set up. If they're both looking for that trick room mode, who capitalizes on it quicker? And you want to set the trick room up with an offensive threat on the field as well.
But we're not going to see that trick room. Instead, we see Cresselia switching out for Groudon. So Giovanni making a play very early on in the game to control the weather, to maybe try and get control of momentum that way, might be foregoing speed for a couple turns. We'll have to see what happens. We're also going to have to see what that Raichu does. You know, I was sort of expecting maybe a fake out into that Cresselia or some other way to stop Trick Room. So switching in Groudon there could have been a really good play, or it could come back to haunt him. We also see Gengar Mega Evolve this turn and Protect as well. So Gio definitely trying to preserve his Gengar for later, prevent Steven from switching to get the weather back in his favor. Raichu goes for that fake out into Groudon, and then Origin Pulse just evaporates in the sunlight.
Yeah, and I think that's a play we see a lot when the Gengar is put out in the lead. It's something that players have to be very aware of. Obviously, this matchup really depends on getting the control of the weather. He brings in the Groudon, so he gets the sunlight up. And then, of course, the ability coming out from Gengar, the Shadow Tag, means that Kyogre can't leave the field. So that Kyogre's pretty much there, maybe Ice Beaming for a little bit of damage, maybe trying to take the Gengar out as well. But there's not so much that can threaten the Groudon here. The Raichu obviously isn't going to be able to do anything with that ground typing, preventing it from really getting hurt by Nuzzle or Thunderbolts. So I feel like getting that Groudon in is a really optimal time for Giovanni to bring it in. And it's if he can capitalize off it nice and quick before Steven can maybe wear down one of these Pokemon and get some momentum back in his favor. But I feel Giovanni's very safe in his current board position.
Very safe indeed. We see that Sludge Bomb go into the Kyogre, Volt Switch into the Gengar. It doesn't deal a lot of health, but it does allow Raichu to switch out. So depending on what Steven has, it might help him get weather back. It probably won't, though. Again, that Kyogre is trapped by Gengar's Shadow Tag ability, so this is probably more of a switch to save Raichu for later than to try and give Kyogre, you know, a second attempt at dealing some sort of offense here. You know, we might see an Ice Beam. If Steven's really feeling lucky and he has it, he might be able to try and go for a Thunder in the sun, but, you know, we're just going to have to see what he decides to send in this turn.
Yeah, and I think he maybe looks like he's trying to wear down that Gengar so he can start to switch again. Does bring in the Salamence, though, which is a pretty good thing to bring in. I mean, good job he has Volt Switch, because then he's not completely trapped. He does get the Intimidate down on the Groudon, so going to be weakening the attack stat, but it's not going to affect the Eruption.
Except Groudon has a massively power Eruption. Both of these Pokemon do resist it, though, so it does not deal enough damage to get that knockout. Ice Beam from Kyogre to deal Groudon some damage in return.
Yeah, we do see the Groudon move first as well on Giovanni's side of the field, so curious to know how it's trained. It could be a speed type. We can see Steven's Kyogre obviously has a lot of hit points, usually indicating that it's a slower one, and with the Trick Room option on his team with the Bronzong, that's the kind of thing we'd expect. So Giovanni maybe mixing it up a little bit, going for not quite a super slow Groudon, but something a little bit quicker, able to get those Eruptions off. And even though Steven does get the Intimidate in, it doesn't matter. He does get kind of slapped in the face a little bit by an Eruption, doing good damage to both sides of the field.
Yeah, so I think it's going to come down to the Salamence here and this Gengar. You know, Salamence really needs to knock out Gengar this turn, I think, for Giovanni to have a chance of getting this game back in his favor. We see Kyogre protecting this turn, maybe trying to stall things out until Raichu can return to the field. Gengar reveals it has Icy Wind, which is going to be huge. It's going to allow it to deal with that Salamence. And also, you know, if Kyogre hadn't protected, deal some speed control, which I think Gio really sort of needs to take advantage of on his team. Groudon finishing up this turn with an Earth Power into the Protect.
Yeah, I think it's now safe to assume that it's a fully specially invested Groudon, looking for the special attacks, the Eruptions, the Earth Powers, maybe a Thunder. We have seen it. Stranger things have happened. So, of course, if you take the Thunder, if you bring in the Kyogre, or the Kyogre comes in, you do have an answer to it as such. But a really solid turn from Gio there. He manages to get rid of the threat. Salamence was putting a good amount of pressure on the Groudon, but having the Icy Wind come out from Gengar is being able to take the knockout is really, really good there.
Yeah, and I think a lot of Gengar in this metagame particularly benefit from having some kind of ice attack. I think most people usually try to use Hidden Power Ice because it's just what you think of immediately when you're looking for ice-type moves on Pokemon that aren't necessarily that type. But, you know, giving his Gengar a form of speed control and, you know, knowing that it has Protect, knowing that he can play a little bit of the stall game on his team, I think really allows Gengar to shine.
Yeah, I think Giovanni, his first turn was actually just the turn that dictated the whole flow of the game. And it's quite hard for Stephen to come back from this. I mean, he likely has the ground on as his fourth. So he needs to get that in a position where it can start to do a lot of damage.
Yeah, we're going to see a double protect from Gio this turn. Nuzzle on the Raichu into Gengar and another Ice Beam from that Kyogre into the Groudon.
Yeah, I feel just there's no reason for him to go aggressive. It's not like he's trying to buy any turns of Trick Room or Tailwind to get through. So plays it safe.
Plays it really safe. Kyogre with that double protect. Gengar going for a disable. Doesn't get it, but it is nuzzled by that Raichu. So Gengar's most valuable stat, I think, in this matchup, the speed stat, has now been, just completely destroyed. Raichu getting taken down to its focus sash thanks to an earth power from that Groudon.
Yeah, and interesting to see that it's a focus sash. We have seen some assault vests come out in the wake of Wolfie's World's Whim, but good information for Giovanni, obviously. You know, even if it was Assault Vest, it might have survived as well, but it's nice to know which way it's surviving and how he may be able to knock it out later. But I still, even though he gets the nuzzle down on the Gengar, I still feel like Giovanni is still dictating the flow of this game, and the momentum's always been on his side. Steven's going to need a really big momentum swing, and most players look to do that with a switch. Well, of course, with the Gengar on the field, you can't make that switch. You can't bring something in to swing the game your way. So I think he's been caught a little bit there on turn one, and it's just punishing him as the game goes on here.
Yeah, so I can't help but wonder, you know, if you're in Steven's position, you're not really looking that great. You volt switch your own Kyogre to guarantee the switch out from Raichu. Okay, I don't think I was expecting that play. In Raichu's place, we do see the Groudon take the field. It will also primal revert, so no change in the weather here. Steven just locked both of his primals in on the field, which could be a very risky play. We know that Groudon has earth power, and we know it targeted the Raichu last slot. It does target the Raichu again, taking Groudon down to just 15 health. That Ice Beam from Kyogre will connect with the Groudon on Geo's side of the field. Will it knock it out? It does not. Gengar is last to move with an Icy Wind that misses the double knockout by 9 HP. Kyogre just barely hanging on.
Yeah, I think Steven just looking to kind of power through the end of this game. I feel he just wants to get it over with and maybe see if he can grab a little more information from Giovanni. He does find out that the earth power off Giovanni's Groudon doesn't take a knockout on full health on his Groudon. So that may be a kind of information, a little calculation he needs to know going into game two and hopefully game three for him. But at the moment, I feel that turn one just has come back to haunt him every single turn of this game. That the Kyogre's been stuck in there all game, pretty much unable to do anything, and we also see Gengar able to put the pressure on with Disable if it catches it short.
Yeah, trapping Kyogre in the sunlight with that Shadow Tag ability has just allowed Groudon to, you know, do what Groudon does best, slowly chip away at its health with Earth Power, deal massive damage while its health was still there with that eruption. It's a really dangerous combo, and if Steven doesn't have an answer to that Gengar, which it looks like he does Volt Switch it now to try and see how much damage it's going to do, if he doesn't have an answer for Gengar going into game two, that could be it.
I think that game was pretty much one-sided. We don't see any Pokemon lost on Giovanni's side of the field. Maybe we see one now with the Gengar getting targeted down by the Ice Beam, and a critical hit does pick up the consolation knockout for Steven there. So not the 4-0, which Giovanni probably would have liked for the style points, but we do see Steven take a knockout there. And of course, he still has two Pokemon remaining against this very weak now Kyogre, so he should be able to wrap it up.
Yeah, and we do see that Cresselia come back in on the field, so I believe we're just completely at a loss to what was Geo's fourth Pokemon that he brought, and, you know, knowing that information could be crucial going into Game 2.
Yeah, we see top players, actually, if they have the option to keep that fourth Pokemon hidden, they do, because they don't want to give away a piece of the strategy. I mean, he knows he's going to bring the double Primal.
Yeah, I mean, he could bring the double Primals, he could bring the Cresselia. Maybe he'll mix it up. Whimsicott Gengar is a really, I hate to say it, but fun combo that you can play with that Disable. And I would assume Whimsicott has Encore if we've already seen the Disable. And we do see Kyogre protect this last turn, trying to get a little bit of information, probably about the offensive ability of that Cresselia. And we see it going for the double Protect, and it looks like it's going to be knocked out are not by an Icy Wind from that Cresselia. Kyogre hanging on with 1 HP, the Earth Power will officially knock it out.
Yeah, and it's, I think even though it's, you know, a loss, we do see the benefit on Steven's side of the field of just playing the game out and grabbing some more information. So he knows that there's Icy Wind on Cresselia too, so if he's trying to gather information, obviously he doesn't get the fourth Pokemon. We could assume it's the Kyogre, but it might have been something different. You know, we saw just the power of the Gengar Groudon combination there. But knowing that the Cresselia has Icy Wind too, maybe gives us a bit of insight into what kind of speed control it's bringing. It's well known, particularly this year, for the different speed control options in Trick Room, Thunder Wave, and Icy Wind. So knowing it has that, maybe we'll scare his Salamence off in Team Preview next time with both Gengar and Cresselia able to hit it with a very powerful Icy Wind.
Yeah, so once again, Geo is running Groudon, Kyogre, Cresselia, Kangaskhan, Whimsicott, and Gengar versus Steven's Kyogre, Groudon, Salamence, Hitmontop, Raichu, and Bronzong. Maybe Bronzong is the answer to Steven's problems. I don't know.
Yeah, I think the biggest problem is the amount of answers he actually has to the Gengar. If we run down his team, I mean, Kyogre doesn't really have an exceptionally great way to deal with it. Groudon does, but it's quite hard to get it in, particularly if we see again turn one. The same kind of issue. If he leads with it just to put pressure on the Gengar, Giovanni's at leisure to switch, bring in the Kyogre and do the reverse, trap the Groudon in there with the Gengar, and then punish it with the Kyogre. So outside of that, I mean, because of the way it holds Icy Wind, even Salamence may struggle to deal with it, so he's going to have to really find a way around that before he can unlock the rest of Giovanni's team.
Definitely, and we are ready to start game two. We see the Bronzong and the Salamence as a lead on Steven's side of the field. Looks like Geo's bringing the same lead as last time, again, that Cresselia and that Gengar combo.
Yeah, and maybe Steven's looking to go for the Trick Room option. That's one of the, you know, reasons we see Bronzong come out super early a lot of the time. It does, of course, and he knows the full moveset of the Gengar, so he knows he's fairly safe from the damage from the Gengar and likely the Cresselia too. So if he can get the Trick Room up, then maybe he'll be able to do a little more damage himself and he'll be in a better position. Be curious to see, though, if he goes for it, does Giovanni have the option to reverse it? We see top players all the time. They let their opponent set Trick Room, then they reverse it immediately, and they've just wasted the turn here.
Yeah, I'm surprised we see Salamence out in front, though. You know, we learned last game that both Cresselia and Gengar have Icy Wind, and, you know, he did lead this last game, so you would think if I were in Steven's shoes, maybe I wouldn't bring the thing that's four times weak to ice as my lead. I don't know.
Unfortunately, it's going to be an absolutely torrid time for Salamence if it stays on the field, so he leaves that right away, gets that out there, and brings in the Kyogre right off the bat.
Yeah, I don't think Salamence is dealing with that today. He's going to send in Kyogre in its place to take those ice attacks beautifully with its, you know, very specially, assorted associated bulk, excuse me. Also setting up that Primordial Sea ability, we're going to see that Gengar Mega Evolve once again. So he's not switching in his weather yet, but now he certainly has the option to, again, trap that Kyogre on the field with Gengar present. We see an Icy Wind from Gengar. Perfect. Honestly, that might actually work out in Steven's favor if he did go for a Trick Room here. But we see Cresselia Trick Room first, which means Geo Trick Room to undo Steven's Trick Room.
Yeah, we assume, because obviously Giovanni Icy Winded first, that he doesn't want the Trick Room. He wants the old school kind of speed control where you just lower their stats. But he then makes a really good read there on Steven's side of the field, knows he's going to Trick Room, and as I suggested before the turn, just throws out that Trick Room to reverse it immediately. So, you know, the momentum's still very much in Giovanni's favor that turn, I think. Although Steven does get the Kyogre in and may be able to do some damage, it can just eat up those Icy Winds. It's still going to be under a little bit of pressure here.
It's definitely going to be under a little pressure. We do see Geo taking this opportunity to switch in his favorite form of weather. In this case, it appears to be that Groudon. Once again, it'll set up Sunlight to essentially stop Kyogre from attacking. Whether or not Steven was able to make this read, though, we'll just have to see. You know, we will see that Sunlight go up once again. We will see the rain go away. And Gengar goes for a disable to stop the re-Trick Room from Bronzong, which I think was a great play on Geo's part. Ice Beam, so Steven making that read, attacking that Gengar, also attacking it with a Gyro Ball. And it gets the knockout.
Yeah, there was a couple of things on that turn that I was thinking Steven could do. Obviously, didn't want to play the Trick Room game again because he saw Cresselia at the start, so he had to make a good call there. Either try and get rid of the Gengar, which is what he did, and that now really helps him because he now has the Pokemon advantage himself and is able to make those switches again to win the Weather War for himself. The other option he could have gone for was the Skill Swap, and maybe he's trying to save that. Obviously, we've seen Bronzong, we've seen two moves from it already. We've seen Gyro Ball, we've seen Trick Room. Those last two slots could be a number of things, and he's maybe trying to keep that information secure until game three, because he's now in a good position to push on without having to use skill swap. He can swap the old-fashioned way at the beginning of the turn and get the weather back that way.
Yeah, and I think the mind games are going to be especially fun this turn, because last time Bronzong and Cresselia were on the field together, both of them trick roomed. So it's going to come down to, you know, does Gio think Steven will go for a Trick Room again? Or does Steven think that Gio will think that he will use Trick Room again, so he doesn't use Trick Room, so Cresselia sets it up for him?
Well, Gio gets to win the mind game on that turn because of the disable blocking the Trick Room.
Very true. I completely forgot about
that. So he knows that it's not going to happen. And now being able to switch as well, I think helps Steven here. He gets Salamence in. Even though the Intimidate's not going to be helpful on the Groudon, it does mean that it's quite hard for Groudon to do really big damage there, and he does get Levitate swapped onto it too.
He does, and now Cresselia controls the weather, which should Rain somehow get back up on the field. Groudon can sort of switch it out, and Cresselia can just skill swap it away. We're going to see Groudon go for an Eruption here. It deals a decent chunk of damage to that Salamence, not as much to that Kyogre, who then fires an Ice Beam right on back to that Groudon. Going to bring it down to less than half health, thanks to a critical hit.
Yeah, really good turn for Steven there. I really like the safe play from Gio, though, and I'd like to dive into that one a little bit more. Skill Swap has a number of features. Obviously, you can use it with both of the primals to reset the weather, but it's very popular with Groudon because not only do you reset the weather, you get the Levitate on the Groudon, which means if Steven brings in his own Groudon, he's not going to be able to knock out Giovanni's weakened Groudon with a Precipice Blades or Earth Power of his own. So a nice safe turn. He was maybe concerned that Skill Swap was coming out on Steven's side of the field there. So he does get the Groudon in a very nice safe position, and he does good damage to the Salamence on the switch in. The crit may really matter, though. I know I don't say that often, but no, it may be in range to get knocked out by a Salamence Double Edge after a Mega Evolution. The only problem is Salamence is still staring down Cresselia, which we know has Icy Wind on it, and with the low amount of health it already has, might be able to get knocked out by it just there.
Yeah, we see Groudon come in on Steven's side of the field, which I think is an interesting switch. You just mentioned Icy Wind. You know, taking that hit to its speed this turn, if that is indeed what Cresselia decided to use, could put it at a significant disadvantage when it comes to Groudon versus Groudon next turn, unless that Salamence is able to knock it out right here and right now. We do see the Mega Evolution from Salamence. We will see Groudon, though, Protect, so definitely playing it safe on Geo's side of the field. Salamence double-edging into that Protect. Cresselia is going to use the Icy Wind, and I believe there is not a knockout. Salamence holding on with 7 HP.
Yeah, and I think that survival on the Salamence is really, really good for him there. Obviously, Giovanni does protect the Groudon. I maybe would have liked to see Steven go for the protect, match it, kind of bait it out, as I like to say. But the only problem is now that Groudon, weirdly enough, the best answer to Groudon, most people think, is Groudon.
It really is.
So with its speed lowered, even if they are running the both, you know, bulky, maybe a hindering nature on the speed, with the Icy Wind coming out on top there, getting that speed drop, it is going to be under threat from Giovanni's Groudon now. As long as Giovanni's Groudon can stay safe while the Salamence is up on the field, looking to try and get rid of it. We saw him go for the double edge, but Giovanni now knows that, and he knows that's probably the optimal play for Steven, so he may be able to switch around a little bit just to get through that turn, or, as we've seen a couple of times today, fish for that double protect.
Yeah, we do not see the double protect yet. We see Salamence switch out and Kyogre come in on the field in its place. So we will see Rain take the field once again. There's the Groudon switch out on Steven's side as well. So actually we see a double switch sending in the Bronzong. Icy Wind from that Cresselia, not going to deal a lot of damage to these Pokemon, but will lower their speed by one stage. I think it's all going to come down to what this Groudon is trying to do this turn. Will it Earth Power? Will it do something else? It Earth Powers into Bronzong's Levitate.
Yeah, and that's a good piece of information. Although that turn, not much really happened. I mean, he did get the speed drop, which could be important on the Kyogre, because the Kyogre is a little bit low. I don't know if it would get knocked out by an Earth Power. That's definitely a calculation that Steven needs to know. It's highly unlikely. Naturally, it's a very specially defensive Pokemon, but it's likely that Groudon gets to go first, whatever's happening. to maybe able to take the knockout. But Bronzong being Levitate is fantastic information for Gio. If we do go to game three, he also knows that he can't knock it out with that Earth power.
Yeah, and remember, Cresselia is the Pokemon on the field holding that intense sunlight ability, and it does have skill swap, and thanks to the Icy Wind, it might actually move first. So we could very well see Cresselia maybe skill swap to Groudon, probably most likely skill swapping to Kyogre, I believe, would work out in his favor. Maybe Steven sets up the sunlight for him, or not. We see the Salamence switch in for the Bronzong. And the skill swap onto the Salamence. So we're definitely going to see more sunlight this turn. But, if we see Salamence knocked out this turn, then that might be the end of sun for this match.
Yeah, very interesting decision to skill swap. Obviously, trying to get the Levitate back on the Cresselia there. And, of course, force the Bronzong to be holding the sun. We do see the...
Yeah, we see an overheat from that Groudon, which is huge, I think. It's not going to deal a lot of damage to Salamence. Obviously, it does get that 7 HP needed to pick up the knockout. But more importantly, it drops its special attack by 2 stages. So now this Groudon has even less of a chance of knocking out this Kyogre. And I really think that's the key right now for Gio to win this match. Remember, we still don't know what that last Pokemon he has in the back is.
Yeah, and I think maybe the switch into Salamence, picking up the skill swap ability there, or the skill swapped Desolate Land, and the fact it gets knocked out immediately means the sun is gone. So there's actually not sun, the ability Desolate Land, on the field at the moment. Steven does have it in his party, obviously. He probably doesn't want to bring it back out right now and give that Groudon extra help. Probably just wants to bring in Bronzong, maybe try and skill swap the rain back up so he can do really big damage to this Cresselia. But for now, I think, it's a good position for Steven. He's managed to weather a storm, a very offensive storm coming from Gio of, consistent icy winds and the weather very consistently being in his favor, but he does bring in his own Groudon.
Yeah, a very interesting play. I'm not really sure what to expect here. Maybe he thinks his Groudon's going to be faster than the Groudon on Gio's side of the field. Maybe he's looking to fire punch that Cresselia to deal a lot of damage. I believe Cresselia hasn't taken a single hit point of damage this entire game yet.
It has not. It's still sitting pretty at full health. It's just been kind of throwing out icy winds and, switching the abilities around a lot. And I feel like that might be an oversight on Steven's part, Even though it's not providing the most offensive pressure, it's actually disrupting his team a lot and not letting him play as cleanly as possible. It messes up the switches if you're not sure where the abilities are lying. So I feel like maybe he needs to spend a couple of minutes or, he doesn't have many minutes left, but a couple of turns just trying to take out Cresselia. They are tied 3-3 and we are looking under 5 minutes in the timer. So we could see our first game today go to timer if both these players keep playing very safe.
Yeah, we do see Groudon switch out on Gio's side of the field. We're finally going to see that last Pokemon, and it is indeed his Kyogre. So this is a perfect opportunity for this Kyogre to Primal Revert, get that rain back up, maybe stop Groudon from using Fire Punch or something similar against that Cresselia. Though I don't think the Cresselia is currently levitating. So
It has Aerial Ace right now.
So this would be a perfect opportunity as well for Groudon to try and maybe Precipice Blades if it's physical, or maybe Earth Power or something else if it's special. Cresselia going for that Icy Wind to get a little bit more speed control on Gio's side of the field. We do see the Precipice Blades from Groudon, and it will connect with both Pokemon on Gio's side of the field. Deals about half damage to that Kyogre, about half to the Cresselia, and Kyogre revealing it has Thunder targeting that Cresselia, not dealing a lot of damage. Does enough to trigger that Citrus Berry, though, and honestly, it looks like Cresselia might have won out in the end, having more HP than it did at the end of the Precipice Blades.
Yeah, and the Thunder just putting it down. Good information for Gio to take if they do hit game three that does carry Thunder. And you can't help but feel, maybe if Steven had predicted the Kyogre switching, he could have really punished it with the Thunder. Steven gets a lot of damage down with the Precipice Blades there. Obviously, it hits both, not the levitating Groudon that was there. So a good turn for Steven, and now he looks to have a bit of a hit point advantage. Both of these Pokemon still relatively healthy, so if he does look for the timer as his win condition, that could be a win for him. I feel that he doesn't want to take too many turns. His Pokemon have been slowed down a lot by consistent icy winds coming out of this Cresselia, so it might be a smart idea for Steven to consider will the timer be a way I can win this game?
It's hard to say. We do see him switch again. Bronzong taking the field in Groudon's place. We see another icy wind from that Cresselia. So lowering Bronzong's speed, not that it was very fast to begin with. Also lowering Kyogre's speed, yet another stage. We see that Giovanni also has Thunder on his Kyogre. It's going to connect with Steven's Kyogre, but it looks like he misses the knockout by 17 HP. We see the Thunder from Steven's Kyogre into Gio's Kyogre. Will it get that knockout? And it does. Wow.
Yeah, I love the way Steven's trained his team as well. Obviously, the way he's trained his team is paying dividends now, because what he's been able to do is weather a lot of the attacks. Obviously, the chip damage coming in from Icy Wind really adds up, and he's usually getting hit first in the turn as well. So, very smart training when he built and constructed this team. And I feel like now with the one Pokemon advantage, the onus is really on Giovanni to pick up a knockout as soon as he can. The Groudon and the Kyogre are both very similar in the amount of hit points they have remaining, and in fact the amount of hit points they have in total. So we do see top players at this time, when they have the Pokemon advantage, it looked like they were struggling throughout the game, and what he's done is managed to bring himself back to a point. So there might only be one more turn remaining in this game, and Giovanni's going to really need to capitalize on it so he doesn't end up losing just on the number of Pokemon remaining.
Yeah, and you have to wonder, are they thinking about timer? I mean, we saw Steven click in his move with 17 seconds left. It looks like Gio's taking a little bit more time, so it's possible that he's trying to eke out the timer, maybe get that last knockout to hope to, that he like evens things up a little bit. Skill swap from Cresselia onto Bronzong, taking the Levitate, giving Bronzong aerially. So Cresselia is not going to take any damage from that Groudon in the back that we know we have, but more importantly, it allows Groudon to Earth Power the Bronzong. It survives with just a little bit of health. Kyogre goes the Ice Beam into Groudon, and I believe now we're finally getting our first Game 3 of the day.
Yeah, we do see this very important match go to Game 3, and I love how Steven fought back. I mean, the first turn didn't go well for him, and he got his Trick Room reversed, but he's managed to survive through an onslaught of icy winds coming out of Giovanni's side. Giovanni actually winning the speed control war there, but just smart switching and smart play from Steven does give him the win. We are going to see the game go to the timer, and Steven's going to take it purely on the fact he has three Pokemon and Giovanni has only the one left.
Yeah, so we're actually going to see I believe Gio clicking that forfeit. So let's talk about Game 3 a little bit. We saw Steven sort of do a good job dealing with that Gengar a little bit quicker, though he did leave that Cresselia on the field for a very long time. Do you think you're going to see similar strategies from him? Or do you think that we're possibly going to see maybe a more offensive option or just something completely new?
I think Gio kind of settled into his comfort zone. He tried to do a very similar thing in this game as he did in Game 1. Obviously, the first turn he did something different in that he reversed the Trick Room, and then he did his first turn from Game 1 in Turn 2 of Game 2, trapping, obviously, Steven's Pokemon in and setting the weather that he wanted. So it'd be interesting to see if he goes for that strategy again, because Steven did bring an adequate answer to it. Once he got rid of the Gengar, I think that was a really, really easy way for him to win the game and push on. I love how Steven played it, though, and he didn't get too stressed by the fact there was consistent icy winds. Very smart switching coming out of him to reset those speed drops and keep him in the running. He kept it going all the way through, and he takes it to timer, just eking out those knockouts, picking them up as and when he can. And I think a fantastic win for Steven to give him a lot of confidence going into Game 3. Gio may be forced, essentially, here to change it up. Obviously, he's shown his hand in Game 1. Then he tried to show his hand again in Game 2, lost the Game 2, so he might have to go with something completely different.
Yeah, it looks like we do see something completely different. This time we see a Gengar-Whimsicott combo, so we are going to get some Whimsicott in this game. I'm very happy about that. Bronzong Salamence on Steven's side of the field.
Yeah, excited to see what the Gengar and the Whimsicott do as a pairing. We've known in the past they've got some really horrible, mean, nasty things they can do to each other. Obviously, the Whimsicott can encore, then Gengar can disable you. It's really horrible to play against if you're the opponent. And again, we do see Steven lead with the Salamence. It's just not going to be a fun time, though, because of the threat of the Icy Wind coming out from that Gengar, and, of course, the threat of a potential Moonblast coming out from Whimsicott. So might be interested to see if he's forced to switch. And if he switches, we don't see either of his restricted Pokemon, his dual primal, on the field. So I feel like Giovanni may be able to capitalize here. If he can force the Salamence out with this lead, which he's done, then he brings in a primal from Steven's side of the field, and then he traps that primal. So it could be a very similar game to what we've already seen.
Yeah, it could be, but I don't know. I want to say that, you know, we saw Gio bring this we saw Steven bring this Salamence so many times. I'm really curious if he has, like, you know, a game plan in mind. We do see the Gengar Mega Evolve first, followed by this Salamence. Whether or not Gengar went for another Icy Wind, or maybe something to stop that Bronzong from setting up. Sometimes it gets Safeguard. Or, you know, we could just Moonblast the Salamence with Whimsicott. That'll almost get that knockout. And followed up with an Icy Wind, though, that'll certainly knock it out. Bronzong is left on Steven's side of the field to, you know, try and pick up the pieces, maybe try and swing some momentum back in his favor. Losing your Mega Pokemon turn one is never really a great thing. We're going to see it go for that Gyro Ball targeting the Whimsicott, and it brings it down to its Focus Sash.
Yeah, I said at the beginning of the turn that Salamence wasn't safe, and Steven doesn't listen to my advice. He just leaves it on in there. Obviously, he can't hear me, but he leaves it on in there, and he does get punished for it. We do see just an offensive option come out of Giovanni. This pairing can be very disruptive, but as we see, it has a really good offensive pairing here, especially to do with Salamence. This was really not the party that Salamence wanted to arrive
at. It really wasn't, and it's so, I think, strange that, you know, Steven just has been very consistent about insisting to bring his Salamence. It makes me wonder if, you know, maybe some of the other options on his team, like that Hitmontop or that Raichu, maybe he just feels like they're not really good for this matchup.
Yeah, a lot of players as well don't feel comfortable going into a game without their Mega. It's the only Mega Pokemon on Steven's team. So some people feel they're wasting offensive pressure leaving it at home. But if one of the other supporting casts can do more work, maybe the Raichu could have done a little more work. You've just got to bring it. And I feel now Giovanni's in a very strong position. He does now see the Groudon, so...
Yeah,
we know who's coming in.
We know who's coming in, indeed. That Groudon, though, for the time being, will set up that Sunlight. It definitely threatens Gengar, though, with a Precipice Blaze. And honestly, you know, if we see a Kyogre switch in here, it's not going to really want to take a Precipice Blaze right now either. So despite the fact that Giovanni is most certainly going to get rid of the Sunlight this turn, there's the potential for Steven to at least capitalize a little bit on that with some damage.
Yeah, we've seen Giovanni make this play. You know, once he's got the Groudon out, he traps it with the Gengar and brings in the Kyogre. And it'd be interesting to me to see if Steven can capitalize on it. We haven't seen Skill Swap out of Bronzong, so maybe what he wants Giovanni to do is bring in the Kyogre, then Skill Swap, and then carry on doing what he's doing while he's safe from the water type attacks. Of course, Precipice Blades is there, but we don't see any switches, so see what Giovanni's trying to find out.
Yeah, we see Gengar trying to, you know, wait out this turn, encore the Bronzong into Gyro Ball. So, you know, we're going to see, I guess Precipice Blades connects with the Whimsicott. So I was going to say, if Precipice Blades misses, we're probably going to see a guaranteed knockout on that Whimsicott. But Precipice Blades did decide to hit this time. Bronzong, though, you know, it's trapped in thanks to that Shadow Tag ability, and now it's also locked into Gyro Ball. So against this Kyogre, it's not really going to be any help at all.
Yeah, that Encore, one of those mean and horrible little things that Whimsicott can do, really setting up Giovanni for the next couple of turns. As I was saying, he does get the Kyogre in. He now has it trapped in against the Groudon, and it is hard for Steven to get the Sun back up, because his other option, which was Skill Swap with the Bronzong if he's carrying it, is now cut off to him. He's not going to be able to do huge damage with the Gyro Ball to either of these Pokemon on the field. We did see it do good damage to Gengar, but it's not really safe for Groudon to be moving, you know. If it wants to move, it's probably going to have to survive through a water type attack, which I just can't see it doing.
Yeah, it is worth noting, though, I think every time this Groudon and this Kyogre have been on the field together, Groudon has been hit by an icy wind prior, so this is the first time I think we're going to see these two primals match their speeds up without any speed modifiers. So I'm curious to see how this Groudon is trained, how this Kyogre is trained. If Groudon is actually faster than the Kyogre here and, you know, can deal some damage, maybe a Gyro Ball and a Precipice Blades or something into the Gengar slot, we could see that get knocked out, but we're not going to see that at all. Instead, Groudon going for Protect, Gengar disabling that Bronzong, so it will now only be able to struggle, unfortunately. Water Spout connecting with that Bronzong, bringing it down to 15 health. You know, honestly, the struggle might knock it out at this point.
Yeah, it's just not able to move anymore, and a really, really good turn from Gio, as we were saying at the beginning of the game, when we saw Whimsicott and Gengar on the field together, you encore it into something, then you disable it. It took a few turns of setup, and we do see the Groudon go first.
Yeah, Groudon did go first, but I think what Steven needed there was to knock out that Gengar. It instead protected. We're going to see a Water Spout pick up the double knockout on Steven's side of the field, and I believe now it is 3-1.
Yeah, it's just whatever's remaining for Steven, it's likely going to be his Kyogre, and we have in fact seen that the Kyogre on Giovanni's side of the field does carry Thunder, so it should be quite a nice win for him there. I love the way Giovanni's played this game, though. He's done very similar thing every single time with trapping it, setting the weather, and all of that. Slightly different way he's played it every time, though, so if Steven was perhaps trying to make a read, he's not let that read go off.
Yeah, it's interesting how, you know, his strategy has been very consistent, but the way he actually plays that strategy has been different every time. And I think that just really goes to show you, you know, Gio is a world's level player. He knows what he's doing, and matches like this, you can definitely see, you know, what kind of brings those players up to the next level. We're going to see, I believe, Kyogre switch out in favor of Groudon. So Sunlight will reign supreme. Kyogre is now unable to deal the massive amount of damage it needs to do to win this match. I believe we also just saw both trainers shake hands. So it looks like Kyogre is going to take a Sludge Bomb from that Gengar, and, you know, we're not going to see it deal any damage this turn. It's possible we're just going to see Steven click in the forfeit.
Yeah, Steven's resigned himself to what's going on. Both players being very courteous to each other, shaking hands like absolute gentlemen. So, Steven teetering on the edge of being knocked out, unfortunately. He did need to win this match to really put himself in a strong position. I don't think he'll be too disheartened. I mean, losing to Gio, you're likely to have absolutely fantastic resistances going into the last round. So a win in the last round, depending on who his other loss is into, might sneak into our top 8 tomorrow just based on the fact he has fantastic resistances.
Yeah, but the pressure is on. You know, he does need to win this next game going into the last round, whereas Gio, you know, he just locked it in. Win or lose next round, I mean, certainly it'll affect his position going into Top Cut tomorrow, but he's guaranteed at least a shot at fighting for it. So
yeah, he's pretty much locked in his invite to play tomorrow. So a really good start for him. Obviously, you want to win all the way out and sit yourself in a really nice high seeding year. If you can take the 1 seed and play the number 8 seed, then yeah, you're probably going to have a slightly easier time. You don't want to be stuck in the middle of the pack trying to push on through. So I think Gio's in a very strong position to go far tomorrow.
Definitely. We'll just have to see how he does. And, you know, I'm actually really looking forward to the next match that we put on stream, because, again, it'll probably be one of these elimination matches. The trainers, the pressure is on. They have one more chance to get to Top Cut at this point, to get that guaranteed championship points, to try and maybe win some awesome cash prizes out of this event. Like, it's all on the line next round. So
yeah, the next round really decides some fates. I think there's probably going to be maybe six to eight players who are really balancing on the bubble, as some say, Scott Glass's favorite place, I seem to recall. But, you know, I think they'll play well. We did see a fantastic set from both these players. I really enjoyed the fact we went to game 3, and I love the adaptations they made between each set.
Definitely. So we'll be back shortly with round 7 of the Florida Regional Championships. It will be our last round, so please stay tuned.